Hey everyone, when it comes to tracking FPS rates in our computer games, many people use MSI Afterburner. It's the one that all the big YouTubers use, and I can understand why, because it's fairly powerful and gives you lots of stats, but for some reason it's just never really gelled with me. Maybe I've got a simple mind, I don't know. But as a result, I've tested lots of different FPS trackers, and I've actually recently settled on two that are my absolute favourite. One of them is paid for, but it is really powerful, and it does have a free demo if you wanted to try it out. And then the other one is actually recently released, it's actually pretty brand new to be honest, and it's really clean and simple and free. And it's a really nice, powerful bit of software as well, so I want to show them both off in this video. So the first FPS tracker I wanted to cover is Clean Meter, which is the free one, and it's really simple, really sleek. I haven't got many settings enabled there, but you can actually show more options if you wanted. This came about due to a post by Violet Mars on Reddit, who came up with this design and asked people for their thoughts, and people really liked it. So then an amazing Portuguese developer called SlimDude on Reddit actually developed it in just a few days and came up with a really simple early delivery for people to try out, although it was reliant on MSI Afterburner and you had to do a bunch of config, so it was a little bit clunky and people didn't really love that. So because Danilo is a brilliant developer, they've got rid of all those external dependencies and Clean Meter is now its own standalone app. This is what Clean Meter looks like in Cyberpunk. You can see it there in the top left. And again, I've got fairly minimal settings. You can show more if you actually wanted, but it just looks really nice, really simple, really sleek, which is the whole point of the design. In terms of how you actually set things up, you go to the GitHub, you click on releases, and then you get the latest release if you want that one, download it. And then once it's downloaded, you unzip it on your computer. I use NanoZip, but you can obviously use whatever you want to unzip it. And then it's simply a set of portable files. You don't actually need to install this, you just need to accept the UAC prompt. Although it is worth pointing out that if you don't have the .NET Core runtime, you will need this. So just go to the link on the GitHub and then you download it from Microsoft.com. And then it's really simple to install and then you can launch Clean Meter. And this is Clean Meter, and this is the UI that I wanted to quickly show off. It is worth pointing out that by default, the overlay will always show up, but there is this shortcut there, Control-Alt-F10, if you wanted to disable it, if you're on a desktop or something like that. I actually quite like it, even when I'm on the desktop, because it does look quite nice and sleek, especially once you configure things a little bit. But obviously, I wanted to show all the config options first. Now, I should say, and I'll go to the style section later, but if you find this too in your face or whatever, you can lower the opacity down quite a lot, and you can also change the graphs and the orientation and things like that. But for now, I'll just show it as full opacity so you can actually see that. So in terms of config, the FPS section has a value for the FPS and also the frame time graph, so you can see your stutters and things like that. Often I just run with the frame count if I just want a really minimalist setup, but obviously it is nice to have that frame graph too. And then you come to the GPU section, and let's say you've only got GPU temperature selected, it'll automatically show that GPU temperature, but if you want, you can actually choose a different sensor. So if you find that the hotspot value is something that's more interesting to you or more useful to you, you can select that if you want. I don't like seeing it over 100 degrees Celsius, it scares me, so I'm gonna change that back. Same as GPU usage, you know, by default it'll select the 3D load one. If, however, you're doing lots of compute stuff or copy stuff, maybe you'll want to change that value, but in general, I'll just leave it like that. VRAM usage as well, once you select that, then you're obviously going to see your total VRAM usage as well there. It's quite loaded out here. Then you come to your CPU usage, and you've got the temperature and the CPU usage there. Again, you can toggle things on and off, and if you wanted, you can actually change things. So I could just say I want load on one core, or I could say I want the max load, or, you know, in this case, I've just got the total load. And again, you can do the same with the CPU temperature. Sometimes I actually like my TDI, which is quite high at the moment, at 80 degrees Celsius, but obviously, you know, I can show that too. RAM usage, you can toggle that on and off. I've got 64 gigs in this system, so that's why the graph isn't very loaded, even though I've got 26 gig in use. Then it comes to your network, and you don't have to have that if you don't want it. But if you do want it, you can have these little arrows that just show the send and receive speed, so whether you're actively downloading and uploading. And then obviously you can have a network graph too, which obviously just shows your traffic there, which is quite nice. But obviously, as I said, you can actually change all of that and turn things off. So if you only want to see your CPU temperature and your GPU temperature, you could just turn all that off and just have a really minimalist, sleek thing there if you wanted. Or as I said, you can add more things on too. If you've got multiple monitors, you can also choose which monitor this should show up on. I'm actually pleasantly surprised at just how far this tool has come in the last few weeks, because when I first tested it, when it had been out for just 4 days, it was pretty good, but it was also a little bit clunky, and how you configured everything wasn't always ideal. You can also switch the style and configure things exactly as you would like, So you could put it in different parts of the screen. As you can see, I'm just moving around there. I tend to like having mine in the top left, but you know, you can have it wherever you would like. Or you can have a custom position, so you can click that and then click unlocked and basically move it around to exactly where you want. I'll just keep mine at the top left though. Then you can come to the orientation, you can have it coming down at that, or you can have it like that, it's completely up to you. Obviously the MSI Afterburner tends to go down the screen and show a lot of stats, so I quite like being different to that and just having things horizontally, just like I like my taskbar and stuff like that. But again, if you want to change it, you can change it, and again, it's quite a nice look, all very sleek. Opacity as well, you can lower that as well, so if, you know, you could actually lower things down quite a lot and you won't have, you know, it'll barely show up. You can still read things, and that's quite nice as well, because if you're then gaming, you're barely going to see it, but obviously you can just see it when you want and it doesn't get in the way too much. So in my opinion, then you get the best of both worlds. Let's put that back up though, so we can see the next bit. You can then choose different graphs as well, so you could actually have the data showing up as a bar graph instead of a ring graph if you wanted, and that's pretty cool as well. You can actually have this start up with Windows and start minimized, so it's always running if you wanted. I just tend to leave it and only enable it when I want, but that's completely up to you. If you did want to start with Windows, you then need to make sure this is running as an admin and all that. Of course, it's not perfect though, as I've shown off, so Danilo, the developer working on it, has done an amazing job and is constantly doing releases, but there are bugs and that's entirely to be expected. And actually the version I've shown off here is actually like a beta release anyway, so it's not exactly fair that I'm showing it off in some ways, but that's why I wanted to highlight the fact that it is a beta release. You can't completely rely on exactly what you see because there will be some bugs. Also, Clean Meter doesn't support exclusive full screen mode. It'll support full screen, basically with the hidden border. It'll support bordered and also windowed mode, whatever your game calls it, but exclusive full screen mode it just won't work with. It just won't display stats. But to be honest, nowadays, you know, we might have Discord and web pages open and things like that when we're gaming, so I actually never really game in exclusive full screen mode anyway. But if you do rely upon that, then you won't be able to use Clean Meter for this, so that is definitely worth knowing. The next bit of software I want to look at though was FPS Monitor, which is a paid for tool. You can see FPS Monitor in the left hand side now, but it is very configurable. This is actually a particular scene that I quite like, and then I've added a C drive read and write data as well. You can configure things completely as you would like. You don't need to have this particular look and feel. In terms of FPS Monitor, it's a really great tool. It's got loads of different features, as you can see on the webpage now. You can do benchmarking and recording data and things like that, and you can configure things exactly as you would like it, as I mentioned before. So here you've actually got more like an MSI Afterburner type feel to things, but it's a lot more configurable. In terms of actually the price, it's $9.95 if you buy directly through them, or you can buy it through Steam, but that is slightly more expensive. But whether you buy it or just want the demo, you can download it from their webpage through the link. And the installation process is really simple, so it's not a portable app, you need to install it, but it's really easy to install, it's already done, that's it. When FPS Monitor boots up, you'll be presented with a screen like this, and as you can see from the stats, they actually all update, which is quite nice, because as you're designing your actual overlay, your actual scene, you can actually see things update in real time, which is really nice. Although it is quite confusing, and it's not really a drag and drop type thing, you don't select this and just drag it on. As you've seen there, I have to actually click something, press add, then kind of select the type of chart that I want. In this case, I've gone for experimental, whatever that means, and it shows up there. But if you are confused, then you've got all these preset scenes. So up here, you've got scenes. And to be honest, I tend to just go with the all 1440p. I have configured it slightly. I've moved things slightly to make things wider. And I've also added this C drive read and write data up here because I find that quite useful when gaming, just for my own reference. But obviously you could just go through all the different scenes and see what there is. Obviously this one doesn't take up as much room, but it contains loads of data, so it is really useful. And you can also, up here on the right, you can change what resolution you're actually looking at, so it won't actually resize things, but you can just see what the overlay will look like at different resolutions. If you know you're going to run a game at 720p, well, that's a weird resolution, but if you knew that you were going to run a game at a particular resolution, then obviously you can use this to design your overlay. I'll just go back to 1440p. As you can see, it's not always the most intuitive. You have got all these different scenes. If we just go back to this one though, because I quite like that. Let's say you wanted to, you know, resize this particular bit. Unfortunately, you can't just drag and resize everything. All I've done there is just resize the box, which isn't really ideal. If you actually wanted bigger font, for example, you need to click it, come over to item settings and look at your font size and change it there. And for example, you've seen it changed there, and now it doesn't, you know, it's too big. So I'd actually need to do that and make everything a bit bigger. But you can see it's not really the most dynamic, and then I can put the box back. But it doesn't really scale as much as it should, so it is a little bit more clunky than some of the other options. but it is also insanely powerful. For example, I mentioned I wanted to see my NVMe read and write stats, and I could just really easily add that. Or if I wanted, you know, I could come along and do something else. I could come along and look at my motherboard stats. I might want to look at what my voltage rails are, so I can suddenly say, right, I want this to show the data for the 12 volt rail, and I want this to show the data for the 5 volt rail. Not that that is used anymore. And then suddenly I'll just change this to say, motherboard rails like a boss, because I feel very boss-like by actually putting that on there. But you know, if you were actually experimenting with things and benchmarking things, you really wanted to know these values, it would be pretty cool to have that. And there's absolutely loads of different things you can have. I mean, when you're looking at game, you've got loads of different sensors there. You've got loads of other system stats available to you, including page files. It's not just the actual RAM, it's your page file and your virtual RAM and all of that. CPU, you've got absolutely tons of stats as well. As you can see, Infinity Fabric Clock, loads of different things. Then for CPU cores, you can put data on for each individual core. This is a 12 core CPU, so I'm just gonna keep scrolling, but yeah, there's a lot there. GPU, again, there's absolutely loads of different things you can put on there. I'll just whiz through this now because you probably don't want to see it too much. Motherboard, memory, you know, there's loads of different things you can put on. Disk as well, as I mentioned, I have data on there for that, for my read and write speeds. Then you've got network adapters. This is also something I've used in the past where I wanted to see my upload and download rates for my 10 gig card. So I was able to just have those actually display data as well, which is also a pretty cool thing you can do. And then finally, you've got the network stats pings as well, if you wanted to know what your pings are. So that is pretty cool. So that is FPS Monitor. And again, you can then save your scene once you're done changing it. And then you just launch up your games in the normal way and it'll just all appear. So it is very clunky, but it is also cool as well. So as you can see, it's not the most intuitive bit of software. To be honest, when I first installed it a year or two ago, I literally found the benchmark 1440p option and I just kept it at that because that was good enough at 4K and obviously 1440p too. It's shown up fine without taking up too much space, and that's what I run with for a very long time. But recently I've been messing around with it and playing around with it more, and now I actually really do like it and I really like the power of it. For example, in a recent video, I was working on gaming over the network, so I stored my games on my Homelab NAS and also my Synology NAS, and then I was playing them on my computer, and what I did in FPS Monitor was I actually put a bar graph for the network traffic, and that was really cool because then when I'm gaming, I've got my FPS rates from my local computer, but I can also see all my network activity streaming from the Homelab NAS. So that was a really good way of actually doing things. So I kind of feel like if you're doing lots of benchmarking or you just really want to see some detailed stats, FPS Monitor is probably the best way to go. So they are the two FPS monitors that I like the most, but I do actually talk about a lot more FPS trackers in another video if you wanted to check that out, but I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.